Hey, good morning. Welcome to Trinity. We're glad you guys are here. Hi, Gwen. Glad you guys are here to worship with us this morning. I don't know if they can hear me out back, but I'm going to actually have the Spraggs make their way forward because they're going to do our Advent reading this morning. We've been in the season of Advent for, what, four is this week four?
So long.
But there's no snow on the ground, so it feels really weird. So, yeah, some people are okay with that. So, the Spraggs are going to redo our Advent reading this morning. Thank you, guys.
Come, hope, lift us from despair.
Come, love, shine in all we do.
Come, joy, lighten our spirits.
Come, peace, ease our frantic worry.
Come, Lord Jesus, set us free. Rule in and through our hearts as the Prince of Peace.
Today, on this fourth Sunday of Advent, we light the candle of peace.
You guys stand with us?
Yeah.
announcements real quick.
It's like the only church I've been a part of that the worship regularly gives me like the chill, like Mufasa, ooh. Like, oh, that was a good one, ooh, that was really, really good. good morning, everybody. I know I'm an idiot. It's okay. I'm glad to have you join us for worship this morning. A couple announcements before we go into our time of prayer. The first, before I forget, the food pantry had our Christmas meal giveaway this past week. It went really, really well. Like, dozens of families in the community were helped. If you see Janet Bennett, just give her a high five or buy her a coffee or something. She is just an absolute rock star at that place, and I don't think it would exist without her. So Janet just goes above and beyond there. Extra days for people who couldn't be there on Thursday, making calls if people didn't come to get their food. So a lot of really hard work. Thank you for all who gave some time. Thank you for all who donated either turkeys or food or anything. I think it was a really big success. So thank you for being a part of that. But I say that in part to say that there's some leftover milk that Janet was hoping to that everybody would take so it wouldn't go bad. So as you leave the church today, the front entrance, there should be the big cooler there with some milk on top. If you need a gallon of milk, just take one or take two.
How many churches do you know have ever done a milk giveaway?
You get a milk, you get a milk.
There's so many blessings this Christmas season. I mean,
Merry Christmas. It's our gift to you.
Supposed to be surprised, but the milk is your gift. No, if there's like 8 milks, if you need one, take one. It's not a thing where like, oh, I want to save it for somebody else. They're going to go bad if they don't take them, so just take one if you need it. Not a big deal. Secondly, I wanted to give just a reminder of Christmas schedule this week. December 24th is coming up. That is Friday. Keep messing up. This week is weird. It's this Friday, right? 24th, Christmas Eve service here, 8 p.m. One unified service, 8 p.m. candlelight service. Kind of a more reflective service, and then on the 26th, the day after Christmas, is a Sunday. Come back and form kind of more of a upbeat, energetic, maybe a little bit more kid-focused, energy-wise service. If you want to wear an ugly Christmas sweater, you can. If you want to wear pajamas and have fun with it, you can. If you don't want to, that's okay too. No, by no means a requirement. 26th is just one service at 10:30. Okay, so if you were planning for the 8:30 service, you're not having 8:30 service that day, just the 10:30 service. We'll get back to normal the following Sunday, okay? So that is most of the announcements. Anything else will be in your bulletin. I'm sure there's other stuff I didn't highlight, but it's in the bulletin. It's also in the midweek email. If you don't get those, contact the office and give us your email. We'll make sure we get you on the midweek. But let's pray as we continue in worship together. God, thank you for your church family. Thank you for the fun that we can have together. I praise you and thank you that these are more than songs, that it's more than just a fun beat and a new song and energy. We're energized and we're joyful and enthusiastic because of what these songs mean and who we are singing to. Our Lord, our King, our Creator, our Shepherd, the list goes on and on of all of these amazing things that you are to and for us, that you say in your word. And yet, we know that our words can't fully describe all that you are and what your love means. You've changed our lives. You've changed our eternal destiny. You've changed our relationships, our outlook on the world, all of it, Lord, because of you. So, Lord, I pray that these songs are pleasing to you. I pray that our efforts in worshiping you are a pleasing offering. I pray that all of our forms of worship, including our tithes and offerings, Lord, are a pleasing offering to you as well. Help us to give not out of obligation, but out of generosity, out of a heart of worship, because we want to give back to you the first and the best of what you have given to us, what you have entrusted us with. All we have is yours. Lord, we give back to you that first and best of our offerings, and I pray that you use it for your glory. Use it for ministry that reaches people who don't yet know you. Reach it for deepening discipleship, for ministering to our littlest children, all the way to our senior adults, Lord, and everybody in between, everybody who wants to come to this church to hear and experience the life change of your good news, of your gospel. Lord, I lift up to you those who are hurting this week. There's a variety of
just different things that people are going through, be it emotional or financial or health-wise, Lord. Lift up to you those who are waiting for treatments and awaiting news about what is happening with their medical situation, those recovering from surgeries, those who are just home and is not feeling great. For those in our community who are battling serious effects of COVID and all that entails, Lord, we pray your healing on our land, on your land, that you're doing miracles in people who are crying out to you right now, that you are healing what doctors have said is unhealable, all for your glory, all so people can turn it into a testimony that draws people to Jesus Christ and the reality of his power and his sovereignty. Lord, this week when people seem to be more open to things of Jesus, the light of the world, that there's lights all over the place, and even in movies that aren't particularly Christian, there's these hymns of your praise, the name of Christ is on people's lips as they are caroling in the streets and singing in their homes. As people are more open to you, I pray that we use this as an opportunity to bring you to people and bring people to you, that we are inviting, that we are blessing people, that we are praying for people, we are giving that word of encouragement in the name of Jesus. I pray that people see Christ in his followers, in us, his church, this week, the week we celebrate your birth, when people's hearts are maybe a little bit more open than normal. I pray for our Christmas Eve service. If there are people who come to that service who don't know you, who hear the good news of the salvation of Jesus Christ, maybe for the first time, I pray that you are preparing hearts and minds for that right now. And use us as your church to bring your light to people who need it. Thank you, Lord, for all that you are and all that you have done and all that you will do. I pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
You guys stay on this?
Thank you.
close, I want you to envision where you are at, who you are with, what you are doing when you think of peace. When you think of being at peace, what does that look like to you in your personal experience? Just take a minute in your mind, picture that, just be in that place for a moment. It's a pretty fun place for me to be. You can open your eyes. I forgot to tell first service to open their eyes. Half the service people are open. So you can open your eyes. So maybe when you think of peace, maybe you think, like, to you, it's maybe a very more literal definition. It's soldiers laying down arms and then returning home. It is the absence, it is war is ceasing kind of peace. Maybe when you think of peace, since it's Christmas, you know, you're thinking back to opening gifts with relatives that may or may not be with us anymore. Sitting by a fire and just enjoying that family time, being with family or close friends, just the people who know you and accept you for who you are. You can just be yourself, relaxed, comfortable. You don't have to be anything that you're not, and you're just perfectly comfortable in that place of peace. Maybe for you, peace is you're out in the woods, maybe up in a tree stand, and everything is just quiet. And you're waiting and you're watching, but you're really just enjoying the solitude, the silence, and all you hear is just the breeze just rustling through the branches. That is peace for you. Well, when I think of peace, my mind goes back to college. I went. Not all my college experience was peaceful, but some of it was. One particular instance was. I went to Houghton College, which is Tim Lyon's favorite Christian college in America, and ask him about it, he loves it. I went to Houghton, and it's down in Allegheny County. It's sort of in the middle of nowhere, and the good thing about being in the middle of nowhere, it's really beautiful landscape there. Okay, there's hills and woods and trails, and one of my favorite things to do, weirdly, was it's when it got really, really, really cold, like middle of January. Go up in the hills to the trails on a night where it's clear and you can see the stars. I'm talking like single digit night where you hear the snow crunch under your feet because it's so cold. And find a spot to just look up at the stars and be there for a while. And it sounds kind of self-centered when I say it, but it was in that moment, it just feels like the only thing that exists is you and God. That everything is just dead silent. Your obligations don't matter in that moment. It's your worries, whatever else is going on, it's just complete peace. And I remember doing that several times and wishing I could do that again. It's that, I don't know, 20 minutes, half hour, it wasn't all night or anything, but that experience of stillness, the world perfectly at peace. At the birth of Christ, part of the angel's announcement to the shepherds was this proclamation of peace. And we've been at this kind of home-based passage in Luke chapter 2 for a little bit. Tonight, this morning rather, I want to read chapter 2, Luke 2 verses 11 through 15. Luke 2, 11 through 15, and I want to see what it says about God's peace. Again, this is the angel's declaration to the shepherds. It says, the Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. Talked about that last week, all that means about Jesus the King. Verse 12, you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth lying in a manger. Suddenly the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven praising God and saying, glory to God in highest heaven and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased. When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. And I know I've been in church pretty much my whole life, and I've heard this story read, as you probably have, dozens of times. And when I read this story again, when I'm thinking about this again, there's one nugget of this passage that stands out to me above the rest. It's in verse 14, where it says, "Peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased." Have you ever read that and just think, what's going on with that? This is in the New Living Translation. The NIV, which is not on the screen, it says, "Peace on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests." On earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests. So when I pause and look at this, and not having it lost in just all the wonder of this Christmas announcement, when I single this out for a moment, I'm wondering, well, what does this mean? Who is God's peace for then? Is God's peace meant only for the select few who please God and then not the others? If so, okay, who is favored? Who pleases God and who doesn't? Who is on the peace train and who has missed the peace train? Because sometimes I'm not really on the peace train. Sometimes I don't always feel like at peace, so am I one of the ones over there? Am I one of the not favored ones? Am I one of the ones who God is not pleased with? My life isn't always peaceful. It doesn't always feel that way. So I read this and I'm wondering, okay, what is going on? Okay, we got to look deeper into this. And one thing I like to do, a good Bible study technique, either if you're studying at home or hearing in a sermon or at a Bible study, you come across a verse that you're like kind of an eyebrow-raising sort of verse. One thing that I like to do first is see, what does the rest of the Bible have to say about this? Are there any other scripture passages that would help give us some more information about this? What does the rest of scripture say about peace and God's favor and all this fun stuff? Because if God's peace is only for some, if God's peace is only for this little kind of group over here, and maybe hope you're on the train, if God's peace is offered to his favorites over here and not to the others, what do we do with a verse, very famous verse like John 3:16, that says God sent his son into the world out of his great love for the world, right? For God so loved the world, because God so loved the world, he sent his son. He loved the world, not just his favorites. What do we do with a passage like 2 Peter 3:9 that says God doesn't wish that anyone would perish, but wishes that all will come to repentance, that all would turn to him. All. There's lots of passages that indicate throughout really the story of Scripture, the scope of Scripture that speaks of God's salvation and peace being offered to all, everyone, the world, that's accessible to all. So with Luke 2:14 saying, "Peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased," I agree with Bible commentator named Joel Green. Joel Green, he says this, "Although whom he favors is an affirmation of gracious election on God's part, that graciousness extends to humanity. It should not be read in an exclusive sense, that is, not peace only to a select group whom he favors, but in an inclusive way. In the birth of this child, God's mercy has fallen on the world. He sent his one and only Son to the world, to you, to offer salvation and peace to all who would embrace this good news." Maybe more than any other year, I know that I need to be reminded again. I need to read this story again of the angel's proclamation and promise of God's peace. That he offers his peace to all people. Because I think this needs to be for all of us more than just a theological truth that we read or hear about in a sermon. This peace, I think, needs to be something that we internalize and embrace and know for ourselves. To truly have a personal experience with this peace. Because our world, and your world, the world we live in together, it's a lot of different things. At peace is not one of the characteristics I would give it. At peace in our world. COVID is persisting. And everybody has these different strong opinions about what should be done about it and what shouldn't be done about it. Doesn't really feel too peaceful when we have that conversation. It's not really peaceful for towns in Kentucky that were wiped out by tornadoes last week. It doesn't feel too peaceful in our world when school shootings are just the norm now. Every other week there seems to be another one, and we get a call this past week from the superintendent saying there's rumors of nationwide violence across all schools in our country this past Friday. But getting that call, I didn't really sense a whole lot of peace in that call. If you're a parent of a child in Frewsburg School District, you would have gotten that call. The more conversations I have mostly with you guys, because you're my favorite people. My family than you guys, don't be offended. The more conversations I have, the more I get this sense that this craving for peace that we have, and it's not a craving for just going out in the woods for a while peace. This isn't a just open up some presents and forget that all these things are there kind of peace. It is craving for peace in our souls. A peace that is greater than all of the stuff that the negativity around us, that I could list dozens and dozens of things that are just not super peaceful right now. The last thing I want to do as your pastor, I don't want to be a downer at Christmas time, but I also don't want to pretend. I don't think it's faithful or right to pretend that we light a candle of peace, we sing some songs about peace, and just, you know, at least for an hour or so, we'll just pretend that everything's okay. That's not honest. That's not faithful. I don't want to do that as a church. But I do want to give God the glory and praise that he sent his son into our chaotic, dark, not always at peace world. This is the same world that Jesus came into. And in Jesus' time, maybe even more dark and more chaotic. With the Roman Empire controlling everything. The story of Jesus being rooted in that time. The government of Rome demanding the census be taken so that they can figure out their taxes. So they know who lives where, how to charge what taxes to what family. Big surprise, it's all about money. This puppet king that is overseen by the Roman government, King Herod, at the word of his command, able to wipe out hundreds, if not thousands, of children just because he commands it. Dead. Matthew chapter 2. It's in the story of the birth of Christ. Jesus entered a very, very dark time in very, very dark circumstances. But that darkness and the chaos of the world that Jesus entered into does not change the angel's proclamation of peace. It doesn't diminish the peace. It doesn't change it. The promise is still there. We're going to close in a little while. We're going to close by singing the very familiar hymn, O Holy Night. It is this peaceful song reflecting the truth of the birth of Christ. It's a really, really well-known song. You know, sometimes we sing verse 3 and sometimes we don't. And we're going to sing it today, which I'm really, really happy about. But this one lyric we're going to sing in a little bit says this. It's really powerful. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Gospel meaning good news to share, good news to proclaim. His good news, the good news of Christ, is this promise and message of real, true, not fake, not pretend, honest, true peace. This is the message that I need to hear right now. When I don't always feel like everything is super peaceful, I need this message of Jesus bringing this peace. To me, this is really, really good news. But with this, I have a question. What do I do with it? How do I internalize this peace? How do I get to a place of understanding, embracing, living into this really transformative idea of peace for me, for my family, for my church, for all of it? What does it mean to accept and live into this peace? I want it to be more than lighting a candle. I want it to be more than a song that I hear about peace on the radio when I drive around. I want it to be more than just going for a walk in the woods. Okay, so how do we receive the peace that Christ offers the world? How do we receive it? Throughout Scripture, there is a repeated, to me, pretty obvious, undeniable theme regarding peace. That the peace of Christ is received when trust in Christ is given. That there is this repeated connection between peace and trust. Connection between peace and trust. And when I think about the themes of our Advent wreath, the themes of these candles, all of these beautiful promises of Christ, hope, love, joy, and peace, I think sometimes we get a little bit like children on Christmas morning, where Christmas morning for kids is a lot more about what they're receiving than what they're giving. And so we get really excited about receiving this hope. But I have this new hope in Jesus' first advent, his second advent, he's going to set the world right, it's going to be amazing. And so we're kind of shaking the boxes, like, hey, is there any joy in there? And we're writing letters to our parents, to Santa Claus, really asking for joy. And it's all about, okay, how do I receive all of these things? How do I get this? How do I get more joy? How do I get more peace? How do I get more hope? How do I receive more love? It's a lot of it is about what we receive, and we don't always consider, when it comes to the themes of Advent, our role in what we are giving. And the blessing that we receive in giving. Like when you are a parent, and Christmas is a lot more fun in the things that you can give than it is about what you're receiving. The peace of Christ is received. We receive it when we understand that with that means trust. Means giving Christ our trust. I was talking with Justin about this week. We talk about church sometimes. And I was talking about the message, and I'm like, hey, what do you think about this peace and trust idea? What do you think about this? And he said, sometimes he puts things really, so I can understand them. He puts things in something that sounds really, really good. He says, yeah, we can't expect the peace of Christ if we don't trust him. We can't expect the peace of Christ if we don't trust him. I was like, wow. I'm going to steal that for the sermon. And I did. But with that, he's maybe unintentionally, maybe intentionally, echoing Isaiah 26:3, which says, you will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you. You will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you. Can't expect the peace of Christ if we don't trust him. Paul writes this to the Philippian church. He says, don't worry about anything. Paul ordered, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything, which to me is an obvious step in trust. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. So we have these gifts. We have a Father in heaven who longs to give us these gifts. We have a role to play in receiving them. We're also blessed with this gift of free will. Free will. We have choices of where to place our trust. Yeah, I guess there's all these crazy things in the world that are out of my control. You know, some of them are in my control, but a lot of them are just these global problems, nationwide problems, stuff that I can't figure out. But, okay, where am I going to put my trust? We have options with that. Not all of them are good options, but we have options. We can trust in ourselves. We can place our full trust in ourselves. You know, I'm educated. I'm capable. I'm responsible. I have all these things going for me. You know what? I got this. I can handle this. Until things are out of our control, and then we're just left with anxiety. Worry. Because things weren't able to be handled by us. I love when God's word makes it so obvious. Proverbs 3:5. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Do not depend on your own understanding. Don't do it. Don't trust in yourself, because you won't find peace there. Yes, there are some things that you can handle. Yes, God's gifted you. You're smart. You're capable. You're all these things. There are things that you cannot handle, so you cannot find peace within yourself. Don't depend on your own understanding. It will let you down. Another option is trusting in others, that, yeah, maybe I can't figure out everything, but certainly she can, or he can, or they can. The problem with that is that the most loving, the most Christ-like, the most responsible people are still people who still mess up, who don't have all the answers, who can't fix everything, and who aren't peace in and of themselves. People are a blessing. People are an encouragement, and they can guide us to find peace in Christ, but they're not that source themselves. Your spouse is not your peace. Your kids are not your peace. Your grandkids are not your peace. Your favorite political leader and what they stand for is not your peace. A teacher, a mentor, an author, or whoever. They can have wisdom. They can guide us. If they're Christ followers, they can guide us to find true peace in Christ. But they will never be peace in and of themselves. Again, another obvious verse. Psalm 118, verse 8. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in people. It's like, sometimes God makes it this really pretty obvious. We can trust in the promises of this world, right? We can, our whole lives, we hear commercials and we see people and all these rich, successful people that they are elevated and revered and be like them. Buy this car, have this job, have that relationship, be this type of person. Then you will know peace, right? No, you won't. You won't. Jesus says, John 14:27, I'm leaving you with a gift. The gift I'm giving to you, I'm leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. The peace I give, the world cannot give. And what Jesus gives is different and infinitely better than what the world can possibly give us. So we're invited to trust him. Therefore, knowing his peace. Last passage I want to share with you. It's a pretty well-known one. Jesus said, come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. This is an invitation. Come to me, trust me, be with me, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart. You will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy to bear. The burden I give you is light. God, the creator and sustainer of all things, became one of us as this fragile, precious, helpless baby at Christmas. And he came offering his peace to those with whom he is pleased. God is pleased with you and offers you his peace. He's not pleased with you and he's not pleased with me because any of us has earned it, because we never can earn it. He's pleased with you out of his love and grace for you, because he is our Father and we are his children, and he doesn't want to see his children, like any of us don't want to see our children, weighed down with unnecessary stuff. Not at peace. Parents, what would you give to just know that your children are at peace? Anything. And that's what God did for us at Christmas. Gave up himself, his very son, to offer us peace. And so Jesus is asking us, will you trust me? Yes, you have free will. Yes, you can find your trust all these other places that are never going to give you true peace. Can you trust me with that? This means saying to God in our heart, Lord, in this world, there is so much that is not at peace. There's frustration, there's violence, there's division, confusion, anxiety, all this stuff, and I know I can't fix it. But in the midst of all of this stuff, I trust you. This Christmas, may we be changed forever by both by what we give and what we receive. The peace of Jesus Christ we receive as we learn to trust him. Give him the fullness of our trust. Let's pray for God's guidance in that. Lord, we need your help. As I said at first service, this peace and trust linked thing, it's a simple but not easy sort of thing. We can understand it. It's rational. Yes, we will receive no more of your peace the more we trust in you. It's easier said than done. Help us to turn away and not trust in things that are not you. Good things that are not you. Sinful things that are not you. Trusting in ourselves, how foolish that is. That is not you. May we know you, Lord Jesus, and trust you. Not as a religious figure. Not as a symbol, not as an idea, but as our Lord, Savior, and King in whom we have placed our trust. The King who gives us this gift of peace, if we would just say, I trust you, and mean it. Help us to lay down lesser things, Lord Jesus, so that you can be elevated as the King over our lives, the King who we trust with everything. Good, the scary, the anxious, the bad, the whatever, all of it. Trusting you with all. We give our lives to you. We give our lives to you, Lord Jesus. In your name. Amen.
Yes, stay on us.
Stars are brightly shining. It is a night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining till he appeared in the soul. Thrill of hope, the weary.
this right here, Lord. This peace that is beyond what we comprehend or understand is what is available to us when we understand what it means to really trust you. Everything around us could be chaos. And you stand in the center of it all, saying, just trust me. I long for the very best things for you. I love you as my own child. Why would I not give you the very best? God, in a world that is hopeless, in a world that promises us peace that is fleeting, in a world that tries to offer us everything to fill the void, to calm our minds just a little bit, we ask that you would clear it all away. His law is love. His gospel, the good news that is Jesus Christ, is peace. I pray that this not just be a Christmas song, but a reality that we cling to, and something that we long to live out to the very best of our ability. Let us be an example of what it looks like to be people of peace. Not because of us or anything in our lives, but because of Jesus. In his powerful name, we all pray.